Hello friends, I am in front of you today because 23 years ago my husband Kishore Kher and I started a movement called Yuva Parivartan, means transformation of youth. This was a beginning of a big movement which is now 23 years old and spread across 18 states. And we chose our mission with school dropouts. And that was our first learning. We learnt that school dropouts in India alone are about 250 million plus. That means these children either have never enrolled into a school or enrolled and left the school. And this number was so staggering that we decided that this would be our vision and mission, to spread and to reach out to every school dropout if possible. It was a huge mission, but we were very excited, passionate, and we felt this was the way forward. The second and important learning was that school dropouts have an image of being failures, have an image of being low, having low IQ, which is not so. They may not have the IQ to pass exams in schools, the academic exams, may not be into that role. But if you look at their skill absorptions, we realize that they are capable of becoming earning members, can earn a livelihood and be contributing members of the society. And that is why we found that we have girls and boys who are baccalaureate experts, excellent motor mechanics, girls who hardly passed out of school and are auxiliary nurses serving society. We have people, boys, girls doing C+ tally in computers and are well placed in urban cities and some of the rural cities. The others in courses like tailoring and beautician are mainly self-employed because they have home responsibilities and other factors of safety, security from the household that does not allow them to work outside their home. The other example that I can give you of our learning is, we decided that children who have dropped out of school would not want the same same school curriculum, anything to be associated with the school. And that's why we had to take a very bold decision and to break the mold of a training skill development center, which was typically as fixed by government and private institutions, 8 hours into 1 year or 3 year diploma or degrees. The other was that it had to have a brick and mortar huge building, a complex. Now that resembles very much a school. 8 hours and a building and a locked in period of 1 to 3 years. Now these students who come from the disadvantaged and socially, economically challenged strata of society do not have that kind of time and money to invest into this kind of 3 year education. And hence we had to do a very bold step by planning courses that were only 3 months and for only 2 hours daily. These are the courses meant for urban India. For rural India, we went a step further and we have only 2 hours courses, but for a period of 1 month. Now you will wonder, what kind of people are we producing? It's not that. It is the main training is, this is the only a step in the direction towards skill development and livelihood. The next step comes on the job. Once they are placed, they learn on the job. And in fact, we were glad to understand that employers prefer some basic learning and given to them where they can develop their skills according to the needs of the employer. I'll give you one example. We have a multi-skill course where a student is taught 4 to 5 skills. Now, as soon as these skills like plumbing, welding, then there was a little bit of carpentry and electrical work. We were wondering, where will these boys and girls go? You will be surprised that the employers who took them were contractors, large contractors taking up building complexes, putting up institutions. They said, we would like to try them out and we'll see, they'll find out which is his specialty and specialize him further into that, whether it is plumbing or welding, etc. We were very sure that there are so many failures, so many dropouts, 250 plus million youth, and India has an advantage of being the youngest country, where 50% of its population is below the age of 25. And isn't this population a drain on the society, on the country, if we cannot even give them a livelihood or any skill that would make them employable? So that's why we realized that we had to look at these boys and girls in a different way. We could not consider them like the normal boys and girls of who, like you, educated and coming from homes which are functional homes with lot of culture, values and a mixture. While these children come from quite a different background. And that is why they are called socially and economically challenged or disadvantaged students. The students require more mentoring because they are failures and hence they have several mental and physical issues. So we had to look into that and we found out that the low self-esteem, less low confidence, lack of communication skills, lack of understanding interpersonal relationships, problem solving were not there. They did not know how to talk to a senior person or to an elder outside his family and his peer group. He had never dealt with an outsider. And that's why we had to start our own project called Soch Ka Parivartan, which means change of attitude, to transform your attitude, transform your mindset, to accept that now I am going to be going into livelihood, I need to get more confidence and I need to be mature enough to grow into the society ahead. And we included skills like interviewing skills and personality skills, grooming, how to speak basic English knowledge and how to travel, how to dress, all those kind of mixtures made up this project or this small, it's called Soch Ka Parivartan. It has helped. It is a bit like counseling, which we could not do. See, when we have done up in 23 years, 10,50,000 youth, how could we counsel so many students one-to-one? It was impossible. So the Soch Ka Parivartan, changing your mindset program, was a little miniature simplified version of one-to-one counseling. And I can tell you that this Soch Ka Parivartan has definitely helped and gone a long way into giving a boost to our students from all strata of society across India. Another important bold step we took, and I am telling you all these things is not about to talk about my program, that is Yuva Parivartan, but more the learnings that we learned and what we had to unlearn while progressing or developing this program. This movement called Yuva Parivartan started small with one center in Bandra in Mumbai, but spread across to 75 centers across India. And that was a huge challenge. because there is a topography, geography, history, and the climate, everything affects the person from that region. And we had to consider all this while spreading the movement across India. We took the also that one of our bylines, important byline, if you look at my logo, under the logo is giving youth a second chance. And we thought that if we are saying that we are going to reach out to school dropouts or dropouts in general, we cannot leave out anybody. That was our passion and vision and mission, that every youth who is a dropout, who needs our help, who could be brought into the mainstream, should be reached out. And that's why we decided whom are we leaving out, who are the people that need help. And the prisons was the first project that came to me. Prison inmates are inside the prison, missing out the best years of their life, maybe 18 to 23, 25. And that is our target group, that is our target age. So we went to the most notorious, dreaded prisons of India, the one in Bombay called Arthur Road, the Tihar Jail in Delhi, and in Alipur Jail in Calcutta, Patna, Bareilly, Rajasthan, Bikaner, and in Pune, the famous, infamous Yeroda Jail. These prisons had inmates who were 18 to 23 and some up to 35 that we could reach out to. And women and men were taught several courses along with counseling to prepare them for the future once they get out of the jail. So they were murderers, there were prisoners who were white-collared, blue-collared prisoners, there were young youth who had committed small offenses, and this was the one of our most satisfying projects. Then we moved into destitute homes, women's home, orphanages. We have been into now going to the help the commercial sex workers, girls and boys who have been rescued from human trafficking. We want to go and help everybody. Now this was the vision and mission and our passion. The other passion was of disadvantaged youth was the tribals of India. There is a large area starting from the north in Bihar up to Karnataka and Tamil Nadu called the Red Corridor. The Red Corridor is made up of all the Naxals and the Maoist movements. These are all the serious, severe conflict zones because of the trouble. But these conflict zones have normal people residing in the villages. So we decided that we will go in the Red Corridor zone where no one dares to go. And we started from Bihar, Jharkhand, we went into Orissa, we went into Madhya Pradesh, we went to Andhra Pradesh in Maharashtra and have done all this. But over the last 3-4 years, we faced some financial problems. And another issue was very important that I must tell you is that donors want social impact. Now, I can't give social impact, I cannot show social impact for prison inmates because they might be there for 3 years or 10 years or 15, 20 years. While same with tribals, they may have no education. And I cannot show them a job in a mall or in an office because they have never been to school. And what we teach them is simple skills that would make them self-employed. There's so much to tell you, so many learnings to tell you over the years, but it has enriched the Yuva Parivartan movement. It has been supported by donors from corporates to foundations and trusts, and we are very glad. One learning that I have learned from my experience is that I have to push my limits. I was quite lazy, easygoing, comfortable, led a sheltered life. But when I came into, started with Yuva Parivartan, my husband had big dreams for Yuva Parivartan. Wanted it all India. He wanted it could go international. We wanted our model to be replicated, adapted to any geography and to scale up. That was our first priority, to scale up. So I, coming from, had so many limitations in my mind. It was all mental limitations. I pushed myself and we have been innovative. We have dared to copy from learning from the people around you. You don't need, innovations are not inventions. They are innovations that are there in the life around you. You have to put 2-3 ideas together and create a new model. That is what we have done. We have taken examples from people, from institutions across the world, across the country, and created a new model called Yuva Parivartan. I am very happy that I have been able to tell you some of my learnings, and I wish there was so much more time and more to exchange the ideas that we have. Another one big idea is, we need to learn to observe people, absorb and learn. We need to grow mature, to understand people. And one biggest learning for me was to learn to take risks. We are so safe and secure. We do not want to try going beyond our boundaries. What will people say? What will the government say? What will our donors say? But you have to take certain calculated risks. If you want to experiment, you want to learn, you want to teach, and you want to set examples for other NGOs, and that's what we think we are doing. The movement, why we call it a movement? Because it started with one center. It has spread across now 16 states. But what we have done is, we have franchised our model to 300-400 active NGOs, institutes, in a not-for-profit model. And that is the movement that is spreading. It's just like throwing a stone into a still water, and the ripple effect is the movement. The ripple effect is what we are hoping, and I have learned that I need to be bold. I have to be ready to take risk and set examples.